For you are my God, and you are enough, Jesus. I give you my life, I give you my trust. Let's stand and worship together this morning, Springs Church.
Ooh. Standing in the place where doubt and faith collide. Staring in the face of fear that has to die. When you call my name, there's only one reply. No, I won't wait, I'll give you my whole life. I will go where you send me, to the ends of the earth, just say the word and
Church.
Luke 8:16-25. No one after lighting a lamp hides it under a jar, or puts it under a bed, but puts it on a lampstand, so that those who enter may see the light. For nothing is hidden that will not be disclosed, nor is anything secret that will not become known and come to light. Then pay attention to how you listen, for to those who have, more will be given. And from those who do not have, even what they seem to have will be taken away. Then his mother and his brothers came to him, but they could not reach him because of the crowd. And he was told, "Your mother and your brothers are standing outside, waiting to see you." But he said to them, "My mother and brothers are those who hear the word of God and do it." One day he got into a boat and with his disciples, and he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side of the lake." So they put out, and while they were sailing, he fell asleep. A windstorm swept across on the lake, and the boat was filling with water, and they were in danger. They went to him and woke him up, shouting, "Master, Master, we are perishing." And he woke up and rebuked the wind and the raging waves. They ceased, and they were calm. He said to them, "Where is your faith?" They were afraid and amazed, and said to one another, "Who then is this that he commands even the winds and the water, and they obey him?"
Good morning. Welcome here. We just want to tell you that we're blessed if you're visiting, and we're so thankful that you're here today. Thank you for joining us. And isn't this building alive? When it rains, it's very alive. I don't know that we'll be able to outpraise the rocks and the rain, but we're going to try here in just a few minutes. So you are welcome here. Thank you for being here. My name is Celeste Dvorak. I am the missions team leader and the missions delegate here at the Springs. And I'm blessed to be able to lead that team. And I just want to tell you a tiny little story. My missions story, my international missions story, began probably, well, I'm just guessing because I don't really do public math, but 26 years ago-ish, I was a baby Oklahoma Christian University student freshman, and I joined a team to go to Germany with Let's Start Talking. So it's an awesome day today because we have some Let's Start Talking folks with us, and you'll get to hear more about that from John in just a little bit. But that's where my journey with missions sort of started, and where a passion for international missions, but also just sharing my faith really began. I went on that trip and that project and came home and started doing some Friends Speak. With Let's Start Talking. And I know some of our people are already involved with Friends Speak, and you guys have met your readers for the first time, and it's so exciting. But that going ignited something in me that I came back and thought, okay, I can do this here too. I can step out of my comfort zone and do this. And then we got to go as a family of three when Sydney was very little on a Let's Start Talking project to Belgium and Croatia. And then when Hagen was a little guy, well, not too little, sorry, it wasn't that long ago, 2015, sorry, bud. Okay, he was much shorter. That all happened in the last 3 years. Anyways, as a family of four, we got to go to Germany again. And you're going to see the Rohrkassies, I think, on a slide. Yes? Yeah? Okay. The Rohrkassies are coming up on a slide. And they are our missionaries in Hildesheim, Germany. There they are. And what a blessing for our family to get to do both a Let's Start Talking project and work with them and get to see how their ministry works in Germany again. Just such a blessing to be able to support these lovely people. And as a church, this is what we do, friends. We go and we send and we support and we pray for. And part of my job is to help you do that too. And so if you at all have a little calling, a little nudge from God saying, "I really want to do a project, maybe this is the time. Or maybe I should start right here in our own backyard at Cross and Crown and then do some Friends Speak. And then maybe I might be called to another culture, another place." Well, I want to help you do that. So please speak with me or any of the team members on the missions team. If you didn't get to go to the ministry fair this morning, I know it was kind of a rainy morning for that, but there are so many beautiful ministries that are taking place here at the Springs, and we want you to go. We want you to go. So please reach out to any of the leaders on those ministry teams, and let us know how we can help you go. Would you pray with me, please, as we begin? God, we are so thankful for the rain, and we're thankful for that sound that reminds us of your power and your glory. And I pray that we join our voices with all of earth and people today. Help us, Lord, as we come to you. Join us here, Lord. Be among us. Help us to go. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together and sing of how awesome our Lord is.
Great are you.
Of God's greatness.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to it trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all and see how great is our God.
Voices.
How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all see how great is our God.
Amen, church. Be seated.
Each week, we come and we remember. We come to the table, we break the bread, we remember Jesus' body broken. We take the juice and we remember Jesus' blood shed. We gather and we remember. In Luke 22:19, it reads, "And Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it, saying, 'This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" We remember. This table isn't prepared just for me or just for you. It's prepared for all of us together. It's our collective proclamation that Jesus is risen, and he changes everything. He brings hope where there was despair. He brings truth where there were lies. He brings light that pierces the darkness. He brings wholeness to our brokenness and our shattering. At the table, we are forgiven. And at the table, we learn to forgive. It teaches us that this grace, so freely given to each of us, is best experienced around a table of many. It reminds us how deeply we are loved, and it urges us to learn to love not like the world, but like Jesus loved us selflessly. His work at the table, God's work at the table, and eternal. And we do this, and as we do this, it is a mystery how God weaves us together into his body around this table. Week by week, we remember. And week by week, God creates faith in us. Step by step, he designs a family, his church. A mysterious body that reflects and represents Jesus to the world. We are all welcome at this table, to this sacred space where we remember Jesus together, and we are never the same. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for Jesus. And we thank you for the sacrifice that he made, that we may experience your grace and your love. Thank you for the love you give to us freely. And may we know your love deeply, and may we give your love freely. In Jesus' name, amen. Come to the tables.
your procession, the mountains and the heavens all will rejoice. Horizon to horizon, creation to creation.
Let's stand and continue worshiping. Give us a heart for the nations. Let us be light to the world. Use us to declare your salvation to the people of the earth. May we be moved by compassion. Let us know your love for the lost. Jesus, use us to lead them to the cross. Father, here we are, standing in your presence. Send us forth to lead them to the cross. Spirit, here we with your power, send us forth to lead them to the cross.
To the cross.
Give us your heart for the nations. Let us be light to the world. Use us to declare your salvation to the people of the earth. May we be moved by compassion. Let us know your love for the lost. Jesus, use us to lead them to the cross. Father, here we are, standing in your presence. Send us forth to lead them to the cross. Spirit, here we are, fill us with your power. Send us forth to lead them to the cross. Father, here we are, standing in your presence. Send us forth to lead them to the cross. Spirit, here we are, fill us with your power. Send us forth to lead them to the cross.
To the cross.
To the cross. Love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare us a place.
When we all
get to heaven.
What a day of rejoicing
that will be
when we all
see Jesus. We'll sing and shout
the victory.
While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign.
When we all
get to heaven,
what a day of rejoicing that will be.
When we all
see Jesus,
we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just a glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay.
When we all
get to heaven,
what a day of rejoicing that will be.
When we all
see Jesus,
we'll sing and shout the victory.
One thing we ask of you,
one thing that we desire,
that as we worship you,
Lord, come and change our lives.
Arise, 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 arise,
take your place, be enthroned on our praise.
Arise, King of Kings,
Holy God,
as we sing, arise,
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 arise.
One thing we ask of you,
one thing that we desire,
that as we worship you,
Lord, come and change our lives.
Arise, arise, arise,
arise, arise,
take your place, be enthroned on our praise.
Arise, King of Kings,
Holy God,
as we sing,
up on our praises.
We lift you up,
we lift you up,
we lift you up on our praises.
We lift you up,
we lift you up,
we lift you up on our praises.
We lift you up,
we lift you up,
we lift you up on our praises.
Arise, take your place, be enthroned on our praise.
Arise, King of Kings,
Holy God,
as we sing.
Arise,
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 arise.
Amen. Have a seat, church.
Morning, church.
Morning.
Welcome. We are glad you're here. Let me join my voice with Celeste Dvorak in welcoming our visitors. When I travel to Africa, sometimes I go to church and it's raining there, and my African brothers and sisters remind me that good friends like rain, are a blessing. Good friends from afar, like rain, are a blessing. So we have some friends from afar who are here apparently because it was raining as you came. So we're so thrilled that you're here with us, and we hope that you're encouraged by your time at the Springs this morning, and that your time around the table was a place where you could receive the grace of God and the fellowship of your brothers and sisters this morning. And this morning we are going to be talking about God's grace. Have you ever tried to fully seek, I mean, really understand the immensity of God's grace? You know, I'm talking about just the overwhelming fullness of God's loving kindness and mercy. The amazing beauty and elegance of God's divine favor and goodwill is just a fantastic thing to consider. Grace is that freely given gift that our Father just richly bestows on us because we're treasured by Him. I've gone through seasons in my life where I've really tried to intentionally seek to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ that Paul mentions in Ephesians verse 3. And I guess I've been in that season again as God has been stirring this message in my spirit. But as Paul notes, it's a love that surpasses knowledge. Now, I'll tell you, I've considered that this may be an ill-advised way to begin a sermon, to state that I have a hard time fully understanding what I'm talking about. But is there anything more wonderful than the grace of God? You know, the series that Ben and Brett have been leading us through is really helping us begin to grasp the beauty of God's grace in the Spirit-powered gospel of Luke. And, you know, Springs Church, I just want to say that Ben and Brett's work in our church family has been really shaping for me personally. And I'm really thankful, Ben and Brett, wherever you guys are, I'm really thankful for you brothers and the ways that you've opened your hearts and your minds to the Word of God the way you share that with us. So we, Brett and Ben, we say thank you for that. Well, while we may wrestle with having a full understanding this morning, I do want us to see what we do know about God's grace. In almost every encounter in Luke's gospel, you get a sense for God's relentless pursuit of his people. You know, God is pursuing us because he loves us. That's not just a simplistic statement or some platitude. This is core for us. God is pursuing you because he loves you. And I hope that you have a very real sense of that this morning as we consider Luke chapter 8. Which is a chapter that's just filled with terrific encounters between Jesus and others. In Luke 8, Jesus shares some teaching about seeds and soil and light shining in the darkness. In Luke 8, there is a fantastic telling of Jesus calming a storm when he's in a boat with some of his disciples. And when they are rightfully expressing their fear and concern, he asks them this incredibly piercing question: where is your faith? And in Luke 8, Jesus does three spectacular miracles of healing. He heals a demon-possessed man. He heals a sick woman. And then to cap it all off, Jesus raises a dead girl back to life. You know, just your typical chapter when you roll with Jesus. You know, I'd love to be able to focus on each of those encounters. And honestly, I had a hard time choosing just one that I wanted to preach, because it's just, this chapter is packed with good things. But let me say that this chapter, Luke 8, may be a good one for you to soak in this week. You know, just spend some time reading Luke 8 and praying about what God wants to teach you through it, because there is a lot to absorb there. But for today, I want us to see some of the broader themes in those passages that point us to an understanding of God's grace. First, I hope you'll see that God's grace is at work in you. God's grace is at work in you. Now, we've already said this morning that God is pursuing you because he loves you. This must be a crucial touch point for us. It's essential that we understand that God's love and mercy and grace and goodness is for me. You know, we must know that we know that we know that. You know, God, in his bountiful mercy and love, sent Jesus for you. He wants you. God wants you. He never stops wanting you. You can't get the end of God's love and grace. And he stays with us when we stop hoping. His grace is the warmth when we're sitting out in the cold. God's grace is the water that we thirst for. God's grace is for you. In each of the stories in Luke 8, Jesus teaching and rescuing and saving and cleansing and healing and life-giving touch is God's grace at work in the lives of those people. You know, he teaches us and he admonishes us because he loves us. He rescues us in the middle of the storm because he loves us. He wants us to listen and receive what he has for us because he loves us. He heals because he loves us. But my very strong hunch is that in the middle of the storms and the tragedies that we see in Luke 8 is that it would be very challenging for many of us to say that we sense God's presence, or to say that we feel his grace. You know, the disciples in the boat were terrified of drowning, and they were gripped with fear. And, you know, some of us here this morning, we're in the middle of storms that are filled with fear and despair. And some of our brothers and sisters in this room this morning, they know the gut-wrenching, disorienting pain that Jairus and his wife had when they lost their daughter. You know, I'm mindful that we have people here this morning who are in very different places. You know, we have brothers and sisters who are experiencing a season of joy and refreshing. So acknowledging God's goodness and God's grace, that happens more readily. But I also know that there are some of us here who are just kind of holding on by a very thin thread, just wondering where God is in the midst of the storm. Friends, if you leave here this morning with nothing else, take this truth with you. God loves you. Whatever is happening in your life, believe that. God loves you. put your anchor there. God loves you. You know, in the midst of the storm, in the midst of the pain, in the midst of every other season of life, as we sang this morning, God loves you, and His grace is at work in you. And as your church family, we do pray for God's healing and refreshing and joy to come to you in ways that draws you ever nearer to Him. God's grace is at work in you. Second, I hope we can see that God's grace is at work through you. You know, we have many examples of that in the Gospel of Luke. And once again, let me encourage you in your reading, as you read this week, to look for the ways that God will show you how He works through you. But I want us to take just a few minutes this morning to acknowledge how that is happening in our church. You know, some of the most wonderful blessings that we have when we live in the house of God, when we live with God's family, is how His grace comes to us through His people. Now, I realize I have a little bit of a unique window into what that looks like for our church family, because I have breakfast each morning with the executive minister. You know, church, I think it's only fair that you should know that you are the topic of many of our breakfast conversations, you know, but I wish you could be there with us. I'm so encouraged by the stories that Kelly shares with me about the ways that you love each other, and the ways that you help each other, and the ways that you serve each other, and the ways that you share the love of Jesus with our community. So if you ever need to be encouraged about the many ways that God is at work in our church family, have a conversation with Kelly, or folks, just look around and see what He's doing through His people here. And when I walked in this morning, there were people greeting me and receiving me with warmth and welcome. Greeting team, that's God's grace at work through you. Should notice the people who are joyfully teaching us and our children's classes. Teaching team, that's God's grace at work through you. You know, I see every Sunday people preparing and serving us communion. Communion team, that's God's grace at work through you. And as we saw again this morning, we are the beneficiaries each week of just talented people sharing their gifts and leading us in worship. Worship team, that's God's grace at work through you. You know, we've got people here that are tirelessly organizing events to help us deepen our fellowship here. There are others who care about our safety and our convenience, people who are taking care of our transportation needs, people who are cleaning up after potlucks, people who are praying for you. You know, I could just go on and on and on of what's happening. That's God's grace at work through you. But I don't want to fail to mention our shepherd couples and our ministry staff. And I want to say to you, the way that you serve us and our church family is very humbling. And when you serve our church family, God's grace is at work through you. We praise God for that. Everyone who's here this morning, when you serve our church, or if you're serving in the community, that's God's grace at work through you. But let's also remind ourselves that we don't have to get to a certain threshold of Christian maturity before God's grace can work through us, right? Because it's not about us. Isn't that right? I mean, it's not about your reputation. It's not about your skill set. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 2 tells us it's not about our persuasive words of wisdom, but it's God's Spirit at work through you. A few years ago, I heard someone who was sharing about a friend of his who had a very who was very flawed and had significant challenges in his life. And he was sharing that his friend had an impact in his life and the life of others in spite of those challenges. And he said something that was very shaping for me. He said, "In God's great garden of grace, even broken trees bear fruit." Let me just share a little confessionally this morning that I went to my office very early this morning to continue to pray and prepare. And when I came to this point, as I was thinking this through, I became very emotional. And you can tell I'm kind of working hard to tamp it down just a little bit. But that's unusual for me. In fact, it surprised me. My response surprised me a little bit. And I had to walk around a while to compose myself. And as I was thinking about why I reacted that way, I realized that because I was thinking about my brother Sean. Now, Sean is not a brother by birth. I first met him when I was in the seventh grade. Sean lived in a foster group home, and I got to know Sean in class, but where I really got to know Sean was we would play school sports together. Well, because he was in a foster group home, there was nobody to take him home after practice or games or things like that. So my family kind of became the default taxi for Sean, and that's where our friendship really sparked. We'd take him home, we'd take him to eat, and that's where Sean and I became close. One night when I was about 14, my dad and I came home from a hockey game, and we walked into the house. And my mother met us at the door, and she said, "John, I need you to go downstairs. Sean's down there." And said to my dad, "Bark, I need you to come on upstairs and visit with you for a minute." So I went down, and I go into the living room, and Sean's laying on the couch, has a blanket around him, and is drinking some milk that my mother had warmed for him. Sean had been kicked out of the group home that he was in, and it was in the middle of winter in Canada, and so he walked about 5 or 6 miles to our house. He had nowhere else to go. He came to our house, and so he spent the night with us. And to make a long story short, Sean ended up living with our family for the next 2 or 3 years. Sean was a survivor. Sean was a scrappy kid, which is a kind way of saying he was pretty mouthy. But we grew to love Sean, and Sean grew to love our family. And he ended up leaving our family and moved away. And we lost touch for about 25 plus years. Because he moved away, he dealt with some significant substance abuse, got in trouble with the law more times than he can count. But a few years ago, he reached out to my parents, and they put him in contact with me. And almost weekly, I get a phone call from Sean these days. Now, he's still living with many challenges, but he calls me almost every week, and he spends most of that time encouraging me. You know? Most week, he asks me, "Johnny, what was the sermon on Sunday?" So Brett and Ben, you are preaching to a guy in Ottawa, Canada, and you didn't even know it. In my life, God's grace is at work through Sean Hines. The reality is, we're all broken trees, right? We're all scarred in some way, bent over by the storms of life. But God's grace is more than sufficient to work through you. God's grace is at work in you. God's grace is at work through you. But God's grace is at work through us. Now, you can call this divine synergy. You know, synergy is that idea that we can do more together than we can individually. You know, the sum of what we do together is greater than both of us working individually. For the mathematicians and scientists in the house, you know, the heavenly math on this is 1 plus 1 is greater than 2. You know, or as Jesus said, where two or three are gathered in my name, I am with them. You know, we can see time and again in the Gospel of Luke where God's Spirit empowers his people living and serving together beyond what they can ask or imagine. We see that in our church family here too. God takes what you do. God takes what you do. God takes what you do. And you do. God takes what you do. And he multiplies that goodness, his goodness, for his glory. One of my favorite Bible scholars from Iowa, if you can figure out who that is, says the Bible has to be understood communally or in community, which can be a challenge for us in our individual exalting culture. But this is a really, really important point that I hope we see here. Yes, God's grace is at work in you, and God's grace is at work through you, but you are a part of a community of faith. And God uses humble obedience of his people together with all the saints to accomplish his purposes. Springs Church, when we gather, grow, and go together, God's grace is at work through us, in our families, in our neighborhoods, in our cities, and in the world. I want to share with you this morning a special way that is happening. We have a unique moment because we have many of the ministry team and the board of directors of the Let's Start Talking ministry who are worshiping with us this morning. Now, this group of people, and they're sitting kind of throughout the auditorium here, but this group of people are some amazing servants who work tirelessly to share Jesus and with people around the world. Now, if you're new to the Springs, you may not fully be aware of this, but we are a part of the work that they do through the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. The Springs Church has a strong history of fellowship and partnership with the Let's Start Talking ministry, and I don't have time to share all of that history with you, but almost from the earliest beginnings of the Let's Start Talking ministry, there were Quail Springs Church of Christ members involved. So for nearly 40 years, the Let's Start Talking ministry has been equipping thousands of Christians to work with mission churches around the world and in local communities in the U.S. to share Jesus. It is one of the most effective ministries that I know that helps Christians share their faith and the story of Jesus with non-Christian people in almost every setting that you can imagine. A post-Christian Europe, non-Christian countries in Asia like China and Japan, predominantly Muslim countries like Jordan and Turkey, and now Muslim refugees that are just flooding Europe. They have worked in I don't know, more than 60 countries, I think, or around the world. And they are preparing and sending hundreds of people every year that spend thousands and thousands of hours reading the Bible with non-Christian people. I mean, it's amazing. And over the years, there have been many Quail Springs and now Springs members have gone on Let's Start Talking mission projects to mission sites of our own missionaries, as Celeste was sharing earlier, but other mission churches as well. In fact, when our youth group went to Belgium 2 summers ago. They were trained to share their faith through the Young Friends effort. And Celeste mentioned, just this fall, we have begun our Friends Speak effort right here in this location, where we're using Let's Start Talking materials and training to share our faith and the story of Jesus with non-English speakers in our community. Now, we're in the very early stages of this effort, but we're already seeing some things that have us wondering about how God is going to use this. One of the people who is reading the Gospel of Luke with one of our members is from North Korea. She's a woman that's been in the country just a few weeks. And we are some of the first people to receive and help her. Two Fridays ago, she had dinner in our home. It was her first time to be in an American and half Canadian home with a group of Springs members who were listening to her and sharing with her and loving her. Church, what's God going to do with that? Well, God is using the Let's Start Talking ministry to shape our church. It's been an important way for the love and grace and mercy of God to be at work in us and through us. But let's not miss that through our shared fellowship in the gospel with them, that God's grace is at work through us in all the places where God is sending his people through Let's Start Talking. We are part of God's bringing his love to many others around the world that we'll never meet because we're laboring and sharing and in fellowship with them. And Let's Start Talking, brothers and sisters who are here this morning. We want to say thank you in what you're doing. God's grace is at work through us. Through us. So let's be encouraged by that this morning. And let's stand and continue to worship.
Where you send us.
Springs Church, God's grace is at work in you and through us. Go in his grace this week.
With doubt and faith collide, staring in the face of fear that has to die. When you call my name, there's only one reply. No, I won't wait, I'll give you.
The blind will see, the lame will walk, the bound are free. In your name, the darkness hides, the mountains move, the dead will